Good morning. I want to welcome all of you to the worship of God here at Westminster. It is good to be in the house of the Lord today. At the end of the pew, you'll find a pew pad. If you would sign that and pass it on down to those you are worshiping with, we'd appreciate that. If you're a first-time visitor, there are visitor information cards that can be found in the pew rack. If you could sign those and place it in the offering plate when the offering is taken, we'd appreciate it. Also, you'll find prayer request cards in the pew rack in front of you. If you have a prayer request, please fill out the card, and those will be picked up during the singing of our second hymn. We finish our Bible study today on Matthew 25. That meets back in the McKamey classroom, and that starts about 11:30. So we invite all of you to come on in. If you miss the first three, that's okay. Come in for the good part at the end. That's all right. We don't want. Do we have announcements today?
How many of you have read your bulletin? I see some hands raised. Okay. Pastor Blake, what was exciting in the bulletin?
The sermon title.
Okay, I got to give him an A on that one. What can I say? I'm reminding you that Faith and Films will meet at 6 tonight. 50 cents gets you popcorn, mini candy bars, and soda or water. Our film is Harriet, which will enlighten us about the adventures of Harriet Tubman. And I've read a biography just to check it out, and the movie's right on track. So come on out at 6 o'clock.
Good morning. So it's that time of year where commissions need to prepare their budget sheets for me this year. This will be a new process for me, so I'm looking forward to it. But get your budget sheets in by next Sunday. You can turn them into the office, put them in the stewardship box or in the treasurer's box, and we'll make sure to get them. Thanks.
I have two announcements. One is in your bulletin, there is information about the Lenten soup suppers and Lenten lunches. The Lenten lunches, we've made arrangements to have three lunches at Oakcrest on the Wednesday before the Thursday of the Lenten soup supper. And you can fill out the form in here, leave it in the collection plate, turn it in the office, give us a call. The thing is, if you're not a resident of Oakcrest, you will need to buy your lunch. It's $12, and they need a head count the Monday before each Wednesday. So if you plan on coming, let us know by that Monday. The second thing is, our office worked really hard, but we didn't quite get the newsletters prepared for you to pick up today. So you can, there are a few out there stapled, they're just not labeled. So feel free to take one. Thank you.
For the very, very, very few of you who marked down your calendars for next Saturday for the mobile food pantry, that was incorrect. It will be Saturday, March 28. So please do mark your calendars for that, and I will be in touch with you about that. Thanks.
So the soup suppers are this Thursday, is that right? Yeah, this Thursday. And Wednesday. So only that would be a lunch and it wouldn't be soup, but it's still the same thing. And so if you're at Oakcrest, it's on Wednesday. And if you're not at Oakcrest, it's on Thursday here. So we hope to see many of you. Let's stand up and greet one another.
Hello. please join me in call to worship. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
Come to the Lord, who is rich in grace. Approach our God, who is full of mercy.
We will praise God with all our heart and glorify the name of the Most High forever.
Come, now is the time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are.
The God revealed to us in the pages of Scripture is a welcoming and inclusive God who directs us to love one another. We seek to remove all barriers that keep us from that love. Let us now confess all that separates us from each other and from God. Let us pray together the prayer of confession. God of mercy, you sent Jesus Christ to seek and save the lost. We confess that we have strayed from you and turned aside from your way. We are misled by pride, for we see ourselves pure when we are stained and great when we are small. We have failed in love, neglected justice, and ignored your truth. Have mercy, O God, and forgive our sin. Return us to paths of righteousness through Jesus Christ, our Savior. And all God's people say, the good news is that Christ calls us to new life. In Christ, we are freed to begin again and again and to live in joy. Friends, believe the new good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven.
Hallelujah. say thanks for the things you have done for me, things so undeserved, yet you give to prove your love for me. The voices of a million angels could not express my gratitude. All that I am and ever hope to be, I owe it all to thee. To God be the glory.
Amen. Can we have the children come forward for children's eyes?
Hi. Good morning.
All right. Wow. There's a whole bunch of you. This is great.
Mm-hmm. Hi, Tiffany. Okay. Go.
Wow. Okay. Maybe you don't remember. I hope you do, but way back on Christmas Eve, we talked, come on, come over, we talked about stuff and how we always want to have more and more stuff, and that really isn't what God wants for us. Well, in one of today's Bible story readings, Jesus is talking to his disciples and to people around him, and a young man comes up. And the Bible says he was rich, had lots of stuff. So I expect he was dressed in pretty fancy clothes. And the people around Jesus said, well, this is somebody pretty important. We'll let him talk to Jesus if he wants to. And so he did. And he said to Jesus, okay, what do I need to do to have eternal life? And I don't think he meant I want to live forever. I think he wanted to, you know, have heaven in his future and have a good life. And Jesus said to him, well, remember what God told Moses, and Moses brought to the people? You know, all the laws, don't lie, don't cheat somebody, be good to your mom and dad and take care of them and listen to them, all those sorts of things. And the young man looked at Jesus and said, I've been doing that ever since I was a little kid. And Jesus looked at him and said, uh-huh, I want you to do one thing. Young man said, what? Jesus said, sell everything you've got and give it all to the poor. Now, I expect Jesus knew that this was going to be a problem for him. I expect Jesus knew that this stuff that the man had was more important to him
than God was. And Jesus was right, as Jesus usually was. And the young man looked at Jesus and said, I can't do that. And the Bible says he turned and he walked away. His stuff was more important to him than God. And what I want you to know today is stuff is okay, but God is more than just okay. It's God who takes care of us, who listens to us when we pray. It's God who we need to listen to too. So stuff is okay, but loving God and doing what God wants us to do, that's a lot more important than all the stuff there is. Okay? Quick prayer. God, we thank you for loving us, for sending Jesus to teach us, for helping us to know that you are first in our lives, ahead of all our stuff. Amen.
Thanks.
Please join with me in the prayer for illumination. Send your Spirit among us, O God, as we meditate on the sacrifice of Jesus Christ. Prepare our minds to hear your word. Move our hearts to accept what we hear. Purify our will to obey in joy and faith. This we pray through Christ our Savior. Amen. Our first scripture lesson comes from Psalm 19, verses 7 to 10. The law of the Lord is perfect, reviving the soul. The decrees of the Lord are sure, making wise the simple. The precepts of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandment of the Lord is clear, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is pure, enduring forever. The ordinances of the Lord are true and righteous altogether. More to be desired are they than gold, even much fine gold. Sweeter also than honey and drippings of the honeycomb.
The New Testament reading comes from the Gospel of Mark. We read from chapter 10, verses 17 to 31. As Jesus was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not steal, you shall not bear false witness, you shall not defraud. Honor your father and mother." He said to him, "Teacher, I have kept all these since my youth." Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, "You lack one thing. Go sell what you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me." When he heard this, he was shocked and went away grieving, for he had many possessions. Then Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God." And the disciples were perplexed at these words, but Jesus said to them again, Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God. They were greatly astounded and said to one another, "Then who can be saved?" Jesus looked at him and said, "For mortals it is impossible, but not for God. For God, all things are possible." Peter began to say to him, "Look, we have left everything and followed you." Jesus said, "Truly, I tell you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for my sake and for the sake of the good news, who will not receive 100-fold now in this age, houses, brothers and sisters, mothers and children, and fields with persecutions, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first." The word of the Lord. If you have a prayer request card, we ask that you hold it up so the ushers can collect it as we sing our next hymn.
Before we begin our next hymn, it is traditionally divided into a men's part and a women's part. The men start each phrase with a call, and the women respond with an echo. In the second part of the song, however, the men and women sing two complementary melodies at the same time. The men sing the top line, and the women sing the second line right below it. We'll sing the song through twice so that we get more practice with it.
Be seated. Let us pray. Gracious God, we seek your spirit this morning from your word. Help us understand your message to us and to live. Give me a minute. I came unhooked. Yeah, we'll try that for a while. I think that's got it. Okay. I don't know why you come to church, but I know why I do. And I know, well, actually, I know why some of you come. I don't come here to feel worse. I want to feel better. And I want to be moved by God's word and listen to what God might have to say to me. And so it's hard when you run into a passage that really sort of shakes the foundations and makes you think about every bit of your life. And here we are at one passage like this, and it's a passage that makes us think a whole bunch about a number of things. And so rather than start with the hard part, let's start with the easy part. And the easy part goes something like this. It was assumed that material blessings were a sign of God's blessings on you. And the more material stuff you had, the more God had blessed you. And if God blessed you more, it meant you were a better person. And so if you were rich and were in a position to give extra money to the synagogue, say, or to provide special offerings at the temple, well, that was a sign that God had picked you for a special blessing. And that was considered as proof that you were in good standing with God. And so when Jesus says that it's easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than it is for a rich person to enter the kingdom of heaven, we have this automatic response from the disciples. And these were people that had hung out with Jesus a bunch. And they are automatically amazed that Jesus would say something like this, and they can't figure out the meaning. And the meaning goes something like this. God's grace is sufficient to get camels through eyes of needles. God's grace is sufficient to claim the wealthy as well as the poor. God's grace is sufficient. And so those things that seem impossible, and especially as Jesus set up the terms here, that it was easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle. Well, those things that are impossible for humans, well, they are possible for God. And so that impossible reach for us to reach God's goodness, well, that's been taken care of because God's goodness has come down to us. That grace that God offers, that loving forgiveness that continues to call and claim us and hold us in place, all of that is the best news that we can ever have. And that is the back end of this story. The story that says, yeah, it's possible. God can make this thing happen. So that's the really good news, and we should marvel every time we gather that God has called us to this place, that we have purpose for our lives, that there is a promise that extends not only in this world but into the next. That should be one of the best things that happens in our whole week, and we have to gather here to remind ourselves that this is true, as opposed to everything that we hear out in the world. Everything in the world that says, no, the same rules apply. It's really the one who dies with the most toys who wins. It's really the ones who are richest, who are most blessed by God. I remember this was an argument between two pastors in another denomination, and one of them was complaining that he had sort of argued a position that sort of looked at maybe some behavior by the current government. And the other person said, who are you to judge? You've never met a payroll. And I thought it was interesting. First, it was two pastors that were arguing about this, and that the moral authority came not from a relationship to God or from Scripture, but from a relationship to a society that said, yes, if you can meet a payroll, you're a person that has moral authority. And the text says, no, that's not how it works. This is how it works. God's grace is good enough, and it's not the rich that inherit the kingdom. It's the people that belong to God that inherit the kingdom. So that's the good part. Now comes the hard part, which is the first part of this story, in which somebody who has lived a good life and been morally responsible comes to Jesus and says, what more can I do? And Jesus says, I have some ideas. And we should always pray that prayer with a certain amount of caution. Lord, show me how to be more faithful. Are you sure? Are you sure you want to know that? And then the other part of this is that through the history of the church, there have been certain folks who are called, sometimes for a time, sometimes for the course of their whole life, to really set aside personal property, set aside their personal goals, and just live for the service of Christ. My oldest son was a volunteer in mission, and he got a pittance from the Presbyterian Church for an allowance, and he lived with a family. And I remember calling him down in Guatemala, and it sounded like the world was coming apart. And I said, Bill, are you safe? And he said, well, the tin roof gets a little noisy sometimes, especially when it's windy. And so there was this windstorm making this huge racket. And I thought, he's about to be swept off the planet. What's going on? But no, he was just living like people lived in Guatemala. And they had tin roofs, and they made some noise during storms, and it was okay. And that was his call for a very specific time, to be part of that culture, to learn what it meant to be among those people, and most of all, to see how the faith played out in that part of the world. It was a call that he had for a time, and his property was set aside, and he learned and he lived there. He was on a recreational basketball team. The average height of people in Guatemala is about 5'4". He's about 6'4". He kicked butt. It was a wonderful time. So there's kind of compensation sometimes for being part of God's family. And Jesus says to this fella, come join the circle of disciples. And we recognize that it takes a whole community to make this circle of disciples exist. If you read in Luke, you can't get away from the fact that it sounds like the women that were supporting these disciples as they went about their disciple business. And for those communities that have taken on calls of poverty, it really does take the rest of the church to hold them in place for them to follow out that call. But some people have that call, and some people are called to live in that way. And this fellow walked away from his call. And so I guess that's part of the question for us is, have we listened closely to our particular call from Jesus? And have we responded with a yes, or do we walk away? And that's a challenge always for each of us, because we can't assume that Christ's call is an easy one, that sometimes it expects a great deal. And in the case of this man, it expected a great deal. But there is that first part of the story, the part that says there is that grace that calls us out and holds us up and makes us people that learn how to be with God and learn how to love God. And that doesn't require any particular kind of success. It doesn't expect us to be people that meet payrolls. It just expects us to be people that follow Christ. So what's your particular call? What's that thing that Jesus is asking you to do? And it might be something simple. Be less crabby. Be more welcoming. Be kinder to those people that love you. And for those people who have harmed you, find ways to love them as your enemy. And for others, it might be a decision to say, I don't need all this stuff. I can live much more simply and do it in a way that is more pleasing to God. That might be a call too. Fortunately, I don't have to tell you what your calls are, but I hope you listen when those calls come. Let's stand and affirm our faith using the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. As we come to our prayers today, we do want to remember the Ray family. Memorial service was held for Marge Ray yesterday, and during this time, we hold them in our prayers. We also want to offer prayers for the Grayson family. This has been an extraordinary year for that household as they have been burned out of one apartment and flooded out of an apartment. And we pray for them as their life hopefully returns to normal soon. And then we have this card. Prayers are requested for a relative who was suddenly diagnosed with brain cancer. So our prayers go to those households. Let us come to God in prayer. Jesus, remember us when you come into your kingdom. For your church around the world, we ask for new life. For all who carry out ministries in your church, we ask your grace and wisdom. For people who have accepted spiritual disciplines, we ask inspired discipleship. And for Christians in every land, we ask new unity, new harmony, and new service in your name. For Jews and Muslims and people of other faiths, we ask your divine blessing. For those who cannot believe, we ask for your faithful love. For governors and rulers of every land, we ask your guidance for them. And for people who suffer and sorrow, we ask your healing peace. Gracious God, we think of the concerns we have raised this day, and we think of those concerns that remain unmentioned in the silence of our hearts. Hear us now as we come before you in silent prayer. And now, as our Savior has taught us, we pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us offer our gifts to God.
Amen.
Let us pray. In the name and in the spirit of Jesus, we bring our gifts to you, O God. Help us to give with them a ready mind, a willing spirit, and a joyful heart. Amen.
As morning dawns and evening fades, you inspire songs of praise that rise from earth to touch your heart and glorify your name. Shelter like no other, your name. Let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save
but your name.
Jesus, in your name we pray. Come and fill our hearts today. Lord, give us strength to sing. Shelter like no other, your name. Let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name. Is a strong and mighty tower, your name. Is a shelter like no other, your name. Let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name.
Go in peace. Go in peace and remember the words of the Lord Jesus. If any wish to be my disciples, let them take up the cross and follow me. And all God's people say,
I think we worked you pretty hard today, and you earned your money. My gosh, thank you so much. I mean, that was really a lot.
You guys sounded great today.
Aw,
thank you for bearing with me through the technical.
Oh no, you did a great job.
Yeah.
So what was the problem?
Basically, one thing was known that was supposed to be, and then I'm still not sure what was going on with Pastor Blake. I don't know.